From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Surgery Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinions featured in JAMA Surgery.
Hello and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to JAMA Surgery Author Interviews. Thanks for joining us. I'm your host, Dr. Amalia Cochran. Our topic today is a review of Foley catheter management, and I have the pleasure of speaking with Dr. Ann Cameron and Dr. Glenn Werneburg from the University of Michigan Department of Urology. Welcome to you both.
Thank you.
Thanks. Great to be here.
This obviously has the potential to be an incredibly broad topic when we're thinking about the management of Foley catheters because they are almost ubiquitously used in the hospital. How did you develop your framework that you used for writing this review in terms of what to include and what to exclude?
So we were interested in developing a concise and very pragmatic review that emphasized evidence-based guidance. We prioritized topics that would directly impact outcomes such as catheter selection, infection prevention and avoidance, and management of complications. And we intentionally did avoid discussing very specialized urologic scenarios and interventions and really wanted to keep the focus on the general principles that would be applicable to surgical and medical audiences.
With that background and then drawing on both of your clinical expertise, as well as what you learned developing the content for the review, what is the single most common error that you encounter with the management of Foley catheters? And I ask that question recognizing that there are a plethora of potential errors out there.
I think I can give you two. One would be placement of the catheter. A lot of providers, when they are putting a Foley catheter in, don't consider the catheter type, catheter size, the one that's more specific to the patient anatomy. For example, choosing a slightly larger catheter like a 16 French or a Coudé catheter for a male patient. And if you insert the catheter properly, you're way less likely to cause any urethral trauma, and it's actually much less painful for the patient. The second thing that people fail to consider with catheters is management of potential urinary tract infections when a patient has a catheter. A patient who has a catheter in place, it's very difficult to get an accurate culture specimen if you're drawing it from the Foley catheter that's been in place, and you need to put a new catheter and get the specimen from that brand new catheter. That's unless the catheter is only a few days old. And I think this will lead to less misdiagnosis of UTIs because an old catheter is definitely colonized and it's the plastic that's colonized, not the patient's bladder.
That makes a lot of sense. And I think that's an important nod to the relevance of antibiotic stewardship in all of this too.
The other thing I'd like to mention about that is that the urinalysis really doesn't have as much predictive value in patients who have catheters. For example, many of these patients will have white blood cells or pyuria in their urine due to irritation from the catheter, and almost all of them over time will develop bacteriuria. But as Dr. Cameron mentioned, it generally does not warrant treatment in the absence of symptoms.
Very true. Yeah, we don't treat cultures in people with indwelling catheters. We treat their symptoms that are consistent with the UTI, and you get the culture simply to pick the right antibiotics.
You are making my ICU pharmacist that I get to work with every day very happy right now. Something that really stood out to me as I read the review was the importance of using the smallest Foley catheter possible in order to prevent trauma as well as many potential complications of catheterization, because that's not something that I hear people framing their decision-making with Foleys around very often. What guidance do you have for listeners regarding selecting the smallest appropriate catheter for the indication?
So most patients would do well with a 14 or 16 French catheter if these patients are in retention for reasons other than blood in the urine or clot retention. A smaller catheter, and these are often smaller than even than that would come in a standard kit. Avoiding larger catheters when they're not needed can reduce the risk of irritation, can potentially reduce the longer-term risk of stricture. So when possible, we recommend starting with a 16 or even a 14 French.
And I would say for the male patient, it's probably a 16 because they may need just that slightly stiffer catheter to go past their sphincter and prostate. And in the female, I would almost always pick a 14 French if I had my choice.
I also noted that you provided fairly strong counsel against irrigation or installations into Foley catheters because of the infection risk that results from breaking a closed system. Are there situations in which it would be appropriate for someone to consider irrigating the bladder through an existing catheter?
Typically, unless someone has material clogging their catheter, there really is no reason to irrigate them. Urine drains out the catheter, the system remains closed and at lower risk of UTI. But in certain instances, the classic example in the hospital is the patient with clot retention or having some clot material obstruct their catheter, then obviously you have to irrigate their catheter for manual decompression of the catheter. This can also occur in long-standing catheters when people get mucus or debris in their catheter. Long-term catheters are much more likely to need irrigation because these patients over time can get calcification or encrustation of their catheters and may need a mechanical irrigation done every day. In very rare situations when we have no other options for UTI prevention, we will do gentamicin bladder installation irrigations of Foley catheters, but that's in the very rare case when someone has infections that can't be managed. And this is all in the chronic situation. In the acute inpatient hospitalized patient, there's almost no indication to irrigate a catheter unless it's clogged.
Agreed. And maintenance of that closed drainage system is one of the few aspects of catheter insertion and maintenance that has been clearly shown to make a difference in terms of reduction of catheter-associated UTIs. So whenever possible, we really should be maintaining that in a closed drainage system. And many of these catheters even have some plastic wrap over those connections to reduce the chance that that closed drainage system is broken.
Because catheter-associated UTIs are incredibly expensive, they extend the length of hospital stay, can make patients very sick, and our hospitals are tracked and are measured by how many cauties they have. So avoiding UTIs is by far the best practice, and there is great evidence that keeping the system closed is very effective.
Based upon what we are talking about with urinary tract infection and specifically catheter-associated UTIs or cauties, what would be our best practices for diagnosing a UTI in a patient with a Foley?
For patients where you suspect they have a urinary tract infection and they happen to have a Foley catheter present, you really need bladder-specific symptoms. Someone just simply not feeling well, someone having a headache, someone having malaise or confusion, those are rarely because of a catheter-associated urinary tract infection. That person, if they have a prolonged Foley catheter, will probably culture positive, but their symptoms are not because of a cauty. We're really looking for bladder-specific symptoms. So cloudy urine, but not just cloudy urine. Cloudy urine accompanied with bladder discomfort, perhaps bladder spasms. We're looking for things like fever and much more robust symptoms of infection. In those patients, when you do get the culture from a fresh catheter, if it's been a few days, you do expect to see a single organism. So not multiple organisms suggestive of contamination. The catheter is not contaminated. It's just multiple organisms because it's colonized. It's also very hard to backtrack once you've done a culture on a patient. So a patient where you do the culture and you're not going to act on it makes it a little bit of a difficult situation. So you're better off thinking about if this culture is positive, would I treat this person before actually getting the culture? Because a positive culture on a patient's chart prompts people to want to treat it, even though the patient may not have any signs or symptoms of a cauty.
I agree completely. And these are important aspects for diagnostic and antibiotic stewardship. And on the other side of things is the idea that only cultures that grow over 100,000 CFU per mil of a uropathogen would meet the criteria for a UTI. And really what we're finding is evidence continues to accumulate, and also anecdotally in our practices, we see plenty of urinary tract infections that don't meet that criterion. Specifically, patients may have 10,000 CFU per mil, and in some cases even lower, but they have clear symptoms of urinary tract infection, and these infections warrant treatment as well.
Again, if a patient is really well hydrated, you're getting their first morning urine when people are more diuresed, or people on high volumes of IV fluids or diuretics, their urine just simply might be more dilute because the colony forming unit is measured by volume. So they may simply just be dilute. And if someone has signs and symptoms of a UTI and they have a positive culture, we would treat that.
We frequently see acute urinary retention in the perioperative period. Can you make any recommendations about practices that would be helpful for ensuring success with avoiding trial? And I particularly think about that through the sometimes used practice of intermittent clamping or bladder training, as it gets referred to euphemistically.
Yes. One of the first things that I do is review the medication list of the patient and ensure that that's really optimized for a successful voiding trial. So I'll look at things like anticholinergic agents and try to assess whether they are indicated at that time. And if they're not, and if we can do without them, when we can remove that anticholinergic agent, patients would be more likely to pass the ensuing voiding trial. Additionally, if patients are on narcotics in the perioperative state, we try to optimize a multimodal drug regimen and try to reduce the amount of narcotics that they're on. Again, that's another risk factor for urinary retention. Some other things that we can optimize are bowel function. Certainly constipation and urinary retention go hand in hand. So if we can treat the constipation, often we have success in a subsequent voiding trial, as well as optimizing ambulation. So after all of those things are accomplished, then typically we recommend removal of the catheter first thing in the morning. And giving the patient the time that's needed for physiological diuresis. So oftentimes a catheter is replaced when the patient has a bladder volume nowhere near their capacity and nowhere near that at which they typically would void. So bladder scans can be helpful to assess that as well and to ensure that the patient's given enough time to void.
Yeah. And in some male patients, if you're concerned that they are going to go into retention like they went into spontaneous retention, not just postoperative, starting them on alpha blockers like tamsulosin 0.4 milligrams for a couple of days can really maximize their chances of passing trial of void. And to emphasize what Dr. Werneburg was saying, if you're trying to get someone discharged from the hospital at noon, taking their Foley catheter out at 9 a.m. is not going to work. They often need quite a bit of time to fill their bladder until they feel the urge to void. So giving people enough time and enough time to ambulate and hydrate to void, because we really don't want patients going home with a catheter if they're able to void on their own. This will just require another visit, usually a visit to the urology office, which is very burdensome to people who've just been in the hospital.
And to your point about the bladder training, in other words, intermittent clamping, typically, this is not something that we suggest. I think it was used historically for many years, and the idea was that if the bladder can cycle in this simulated scenario, patient would be more likely to pass the voiding trial. But the current evidence really does not support efficacy of this practice, and there have been some trials that have shown no benefit in terms of the intermittent clamping. In theory, this can even lead to repetitive ischemia and reperfusion in the bladder tissue. This could contribute to oxidative stress and tissue damage of the bladder. So for those reasons, I typically don't recommend it.
It also puts them at risk for UTI because it's meant to be a draining system. And if you think about it conceptually, they have material in their urethra and a filling bladder at the same time. It's actually very uncomfortable and very distressing for patients because they feel like they need to urinate and they can't. So it's overall discouraged. And I don't think anyone in the urology world recommends doing that.
That is very helpful for the non-urology surgeons that are listening, I think. My last question that I have for you is that certainly sometimes we encounter patients who have long-term catheterization for one reason or another. And which patients are poor candidates for long-term catheterization and why?
A good assumption is that there is no patient that's a good candidate for very long-term catheterization until proven otherwise. So essentially, if a patient is expected to have a catheter really in the long term, talking about several months or years, we have multiple alternatives that can provide them a better quality of life, as well as a better management strategy for their caregivers. So patients who are known or expected to have catheters for several months and years often would do better with a suprapubic tube, for example, or if they have the functional and status and dexterity, perhaps intermittent catheterization. The risks of these really long-term catheters are urethral erosion, for example, recurrent urinary tract infection, as well as bladder trauma from having that consistently present in the bladder over the course of years.
And I think the exception to that is we all take care of people at the end of their life, patients in palliative care where they are having a lot of difficulty dealing with their incontinence and perineal care. Then it's a patient-to-patient decision, and you can use shared decision-making with them and their caregivers to decide if a Foley catheter is the best choice at this time. But you really don't want a urethral Foley in for very long, as a suprapubic tube can be done, even in interventional radiology without general anesthetic, pretty safely. And it's a much more comfortable catheter. A suprapubic tube is placed near the dome of the bladder where it's less sensate. And then they don't have the perineal trauma and discomfort of having a Foley in their urethra. So either in their vagina where they are sitting on it or in the penis, which is also very uncomfortable. So as a rule, we do not manage people long-term with Foley catheters. We convert them to suprapubic or have them do clean intermittent catheterization.
Suprapubic catheters also typically interfere less with sexual activity. So in patients wherein that's a priority, this is another reason to consider that alternative strategy.
This has really been a thought-provoking conversation about something that we all tend to pretend is a pretty straightforward topic, Dr. Cameron and Dr. Werneburg, but thank you both so much for your time today.
Great. Thank you for having us.
Thanks very much for having us.
I am Dr. Amalia Cochran, web and social media editor for JAMA Surgery, and I've been speaking with Dr. Ann Cameron and Dr. Glenn Werneburg about their review of Foley catheter management. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.